It's a great pleasure to welcome you to the second annual university celebration of Veterans Day. I want to start out by thanking Aneesah Ali. Where's Aneesah? There's Aneesah, who's really been the driving force behind getting this together. And most of all, of course, to thank you for showing up and participating in this event. I also want to apologize. I will be running out after talking, which is sort of my destiny these days in terms of going from appointment to appointment. But I was particularly keen to come and to extend not only my personal, but our institutional appreciation for you, the veterans who are part of the university community. A couple of weeks ago, I was actually at the Naval Academy in Annapolis and had lunch with some of the midshipmen. And you know, they're really bright. Our kids are really bright too, of course, here, and it's wonderful to see. But what comes across that's a little different is the leadership demonstration and potential you already see in women and men who are really somewhere between, you know, 18 and 22. They've already had experience. One young man that I was talking to had spent the summer basically responsible for 300 plebes, first years, guiding their activities throughout the summer with responsibility for not only planning but monitoring. And this is the sort of experience, of course, in leadership that makes you such valuable parts of the university community. But it's not just leadership, of course, for the sake of leadership, but dedication to a goal that's so much higher. Many more years ago, I was actually on a Trident submarine. And it really strikes you, of course, the bunks are right between the missile tubes. And so you have, you know, the sailors, the submariners, lying there with their arms almost around these megaton missiles that serve as America's actually best defense against nuclear destruction. And it's this combination of being able to lead and being able to respond and to be dedicated to a higher goal that I think is so impressive and that we're so thankful for. At the university, we don't, of course, have our hands around instant safety and destruction in the same way. But we really believe firmly that what we do here will have an impact on the nation, on the world, through our discoveries, through our contributions. And to that end, I want to thank you for being part of that enterprise, to celebrate your contributions. And one wonderful thing here is to see people from all walks of life across the university, to thank you for your contributions in that fashion, and to look forward to working with you, not only in terms of teaching and leadership, but also devotion to the higher good. So thank you very much. And with that, I will turn it over to our color guard.
If you would all please stand for the posting of the colors.
Let's be the flag of the United States. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
I'm happy to see that we're still being joined by more guests. I get to give you a little bit of background of the university's Veterans Outreach Initiative. I see some familiar faces from prior events, and so I'm not going to go into great detail. I did talk more about this at our first annual recognition of Veterans Day. But in general, what I can say is that this initiative is at the nexus of the university's institutional mission as it relates to attracting and retaining the most talented faculty, staff, and students, and also the meeting of the university's obligation as a federal contractor to affirmatively reach out to veterans through recruitment, training, and taking other positive steps. And in short, we're doing more to engage veterans in the fulfillment of the university's institutional mission. So our participation in the Yellow Ribbon Program for students is just one example. This is a good idea for so many reasons. I won't try to go into them all. But as a group, we know that veterans bring experienced leadership and team building into the workplace. They know how to break down problems and solve them. They're disciplined, focused. These qualities and more are valuable assets for any institution looking to compete and excel. I'd like to acknowledge the provost, who has supported this from the first time that I brought it to his attention. He immediately saw that this was a good idea and a good direction for the university. I want to thank our hosts, the Social Sciences Dean's Office. They've graciously allowed us to use their space for today. I'd like to thank Communications for their coverage of today's event, so that your colleagues who were not able to come will be able to still experience and see it over the internet. I also would like to thank Alumni Relations and Development for contributing the gifts and also helping with the photography around it. And I have, he's going to be very embarrassed, but I have a brand new administrative assistant, Mitchell Kitlow, so I'm sure you met him out there, and he had to jump in and swim, and we'll debrief on the experience afterwards. So our accomplishments, as I said, this is our second annual recognition of veterans, and just by quarter, I'd like to tell you some of the things that the committee has assisted with our achievement. So in the fall, we had the first breakfast. In the winter quarter, some of you attended, and I hope most of you were invited to participate in the humanities and civic engagement production of Hercules and the pre-production discussion with the producer of that great opera. As a result, we were all invited to come to a dress rehearsal downtown free and experience and participate in the post-production panel discussion that the university hosted. In the spring quarter, all veterans were invited to join President Zimmer in honoring graduating veterans and hear from Professor Fred Donner and senior lecturer Stan McCracken, who's been one of our stalwart committee members and leaders, about their experiences and what impact those experiences have had on their lives. In the summer, some of you here joined me. I called it the University of Chicago Posse. We represented the university at the Illinois Warriors Summit at Soldiers Field, and I would have to say through thick and thin, it was some crazy weather that day. We got to talk with prospective students and job seekers about the merits of working and studying at the University of Chicago. Also in the summer, we began continued our broader discussions across the institution and beyond the institution, for example, with civic engagement, with federal relations, and with the Diversity Leadership Council about possibilities for collaborations. We use survey feedback to identify interests and organize a committee structure that included veteran leadership. The purpose of which is to prioritize topics and issues and eventually leading to making recommendations. So for 2011-12, the Veterans Outreach Committee goals address student staff, include student staff and academic representatives. The representatives come from academic and administrative units and support services, booth, the biological sciences, SSA, SSD, ARD, finance and administration, campus and student life, perspectives, our employee initiative program, and student counseling services. All are participating in this initiative. We're looking to raise awareness of the presence of veterans on campus, to attract talented veterans to the university so they can help with the achievement of our core mission, to build community among the veterans who are already at the University of Chicago, and to identify opportunities for incorporating best practices into recruitment and retention of veterans. We have three subcommittees. Activities and events is the first one, and this is the product of one of their very first projects. This and other activities will occur throughout the academic year. Outreach and recruitment is our second subcommittee. Their goals, their focus includes their focus is on veterans on staff and those seeking, it addresses veterans on staff and those seeking employment and veterans who are current and prospective students. For example, how might components of the existing university programs be organized to create veterans-focused transition program? Considering what are the implications of cutbacks to federal funding of the Yellow Ribbon Program? What does that mean for our student veterans who are already here? And service is the third subcommittee. We're looking to raise awareness among veterans of the scope of existing services through student counseling and perspectives. For example, many veterans are not aware that counseling for post-traumatic stress is offered by the university, and also support to families. We'll be assessing and addressing additional support service needs that veterans have and organizing opportunities for veterans to perform service projects. That was an interesting twist when I participated in, brought veterans together for focus groups and one-on-ones. I see Howard here. He's been a supporter from the beginning and also pushing the institution. And some of the feedback from the veterans was that we're service oriented. We would be interested in finding ways that University of Chicago veterans can serve the university community. So we'll be looking at that as well. So it's been an exciting year. I would say that, I feel like crying. We're still at the beginning. It's very much a group effort. We welcome your ideas. To those present who are not veterans, we deeply appreciate your show of support. And to the University of Chicago veterans who are here, we thank you for your service.
Welcome again, brothers and sisters. I'm so happy and proud to see you all here. My name is Fountain Walker, and I'm a commander with the University of Chicago Police Department. And so from the PD and the veterans there, hoorah! Yesterday was Marine Corps birthday.
Hoorah!
There you go. That's what I'm talking. Don't get me started. All right. So I have the pleasure and distinct honor of introducing our keynote speaker. He is Dean Daniel Shannon of the Graham School of Continuing Liberal and Professional Studies. He's also a U.S. Army veteran. Daniel Shannon is a dean of the William B. and Catherine V. Graham School of Continuing Liberal and Professional Studies. He was appointed dean in September of 1996. Shannon has received his PhD in political science and a BA in Slavic studies from the University of Washington and was a Kellogg Fellow at the University of Oxford. He has written widely on continuing higher education and served as the editor of the Continuing Higher Education Review. Shannon has provided leadership in the field of continuing and adult education as president of the University Continuing Education Association and is a recipient of the association's Julius M. Nolte Award for Extraordinary Leadership. Prior to his university career, he worked in commercial broadcasting and film. He was program manager on air talent and a developer of the classical musical format for King FM Seattle, which continues today and is available on the web. He was program director of King AM, Seattle's NBC affiliate, and provided voiceovers for King TV's documentary productions. In addition, he did voice work for commercial film production. Shannon is a post-Korean War veteran. He served 3 years in the Army as public information and radio broadcast specialist. He is actively engaged in civic affairs as Mayor Pro Tem City of Montlake Terrace, Chair of the Seattle Board of Parks and Recreation, Chair of the Redondo Beach Board of Parks and Recreation, and as a member of the Whitefish Bay, Wisconsin Board of Education. I introduce to you Dean Shannon.
Thank you very much, and thanks also to Dean Hansen for the facilities as well. I'm very much aware that I'm between you and breakfast, so I'll try and keep my remarks short and targeted. I must confess at the outset that before I accepted the invitation to join you this morning and talk about being a veteran with veterans, I knew literally nothing about Veterans Day, except that it occurred sometime around this period each year. So at the risk of saying something you already know, I'd like to take a minute or two, with your indulgence, to recount the origins and intention of this commemorative day and follow with the role of individual and institutional stories in supporting or explaining Veterans Day. The history begins on November of 1919, 1 year after the cessation of hostilities in the First World War, when President Woodrow Wilson proclaimed November 11th as the first commemoration of Armistice Day. In his words, to be filled with pride in the heroism of those who died in the country's service and with gratitude for victory. Well, 7 years passed before the Congress on June 4th, 1926 officially recognized the end of World War I in a concurrent resolution that as well mandated the display of the American flag on all government buildings on November 11th, inviting the people of the United States to observe the day in schools and churches and other suitable places with appropriate ceremonies of friendly relations with other peoples. This focus of the resolution and its declaration was upon nations and their peaceful relations, not upon the combatants of the war or its veterans. It wasn't until 1938 that the day was set aside to honor veterans of World War I when Congress made the 11th of November each year a legal holiday, but calling it Armistice Day. In 1954, after World War II had required the greatest mobilization of soldiers, sailors, Marines, and airmen in the nation's history, and after American forces had fought aggression in Korea, the 83rd Congress, at the urging of veteran service organizations, amended the Act of 1938 by striking the word armistice and replacing it with the word veteran. With the approval of this legislation on June 1, 1954, November 11th became a day to honor veterans of all wars. One other small hiccup in this story of why today occurred when Congress passed a bill intended to ensure three-day weekends for federal employees by celebrating four national holidays on Mondays: Washington's birthday, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, and Columbus Day. The consequence of picking Mondays for each of these holidays caused, following passage of the bill, the observance of Veterans Day on October 25, 1971, a consequence that met no one's approval. So 4 years later, Congress passed legislation that returned the day to November 11, where it is celebrated regardless of the day of the week on which it falls. So this day is about you and me, individually and collectively, and occasionally the institutions that support us. So I'd like to knit together in the next few minutes the notions of individual stories and institutional stories, narratives if you will, which when told help understand the reason why we celebrate this day. That what we are celebrating or remembering today are the experiences of those who served and the contributions they made. While each of us may have shared common experiences in the service, there is nonetheless a remarkable uniqueness in each of our stories about that time. Stories I've observed that are not often told, if at all. And it seems to me that the one way we as veterans can relate to this day is through the recollection of the experiences we had while in the service and to celebrate their contributions to mission. By way of illustration, for example, my father-in-law was 17, lived on the north side of Chicago, when he enlisted in the Marines during the Second World War. Following basic training, he was assigned to the Essex-class aircraft carrier, the USS Bunker Hill. The Bunker Hill was stationed in the South Pacific, took part in the carrier raid on Truk, the Marianas invasion, the Marshall Islands invasion, the Gilbert Islands invasion, as well as raids on many Japanese bases in the Pacific. She took a respite in the middle of the war, returning to Bremerton, Washington for repairs, and returned to combat in January of 1945 to support the Iwo Jima invasion. Whether he was aboard for all of the strikes before the Iwo Jima invasion, I don't know. He doesn't talk about it. But 4 months after the Bunker Hill returned to service in 1945, while off Okinawa, near the islands of Kyushu, the carrier was struck by two kamikaze planes in suicide attacks within minutes of each other. The first was a Zero fighter, whose 250-kilogram bomb, unexploded, tore through the vessel and exploded in the sea before the aircraft struck the flight deck, raking through most of the planes on board and setting them ablaze. 30 seconds later, another Zero fighter repeated the same attack, dropping its 250-kilogram bomb that ignited aviation fuel and then suicidally plunged into the flight deck, slamming into the control tower, piercing the deck. Flames and towering plumes of toxic smoke enveloped the carrier's upper decks. Amid the chaos, Bunker Hill's chief engineer, topside, when hit, ran down five decks, passing soldiers and Marines who were evacuating, and made it to the engine compartment 25 feet below the sea level. He knew the ship was burning above him, and it could sink at any minute. But deep below in the engine and boiler rooms, the engineer kept the engines running, controlling dials in the smoke-filled dark, allowing Bunker Hill to sail out of the range of further attacks. Amid the panic at one point, he opened the public address system and announced, "This is the chief engineer. The ship is not sinking, it is not in danger of sinking, and it will not sink. So put your minds to rest at that." The two kamikaze attacks killed 373 men aboard the Bunker Hill and wounded 264 more. But nearly 2,800 crew members survived. Badly damaged, she limped back to Pearl Harbor under her own steam. Now, I know this story because it's been documented in many places. Most recently, in the obituary of the chief engineer that I talked about, who passed away in this past October. I know this from these sources, but not from hearing it from my father-in-law. He talks about the girls he met in Bremerton, but little about being on board the Bunker Hill. 2 years ago, we accompanied him on a visit to the National World War II Museum in New Orleans. This is a remarkable place, situated on two city blocks on Magazine Street. The museum is both a repository of oral histories of both theaters of war, Europe and Pacific, that support research, and, as importantly, is a curated exhibit that chronicles the course of the war in both theaters, told through the stories of men and women whose lives were forever changed by the experience. The visit to the museum by my father-in-law was an opportunity for him to set in a context his experiences in the South Pacific, but most importantly, to leave his oral history, his story of his time as a Marine in the South Pacific. It was as important for him to tell his story as it was for the museum to have another telling of the story of the Bunker Hill, another recounting of what went on when it was hit almost mortally by those two kamikaze pilots. It is the cumulative effect of telling each of our stories that the whole story is told. Stephen Ambrose, historian and author of D-Day and Citizen Soldiers, biographer of Nixon and Eisenhower, as well as technical director on the film Saving Private Ryan, was the visionary who guided the creation of the World War II Museum and its early development before his untimely death. He felt profoundly that the story of the Second World War needed to be told from the point of view of the common soldier, sailor, airman, or Marine, not just from the general in command or the general staff. And thus, the World War II Museum is about the individual stories of those who fought and died that collectively tells the story of the Second World War and celebrates its veterans. Each story adds to the narrative of a single event or a series of events or a period of time. Unfortunately, many stories go unrecounted, like my father-in-law's, unless someone chronicles it so that the whole story can be told. And what are your stories? Well, I almost never recount any part of my time in the service. Andy and I before were recounting a little bit of our experiences. My time in the service was unremarkable, unless I count the time at Fort Detrick, Maryland, when I was a volunteer at the Biological and Chemical Warfare Laboratories and the subject of a test of British-made riot gas, or the experiments involving LSD, which we didn't find out about until decades after I was discharged. I don't find many occasions to talk about this. Or on the light side, the practice of the lab tech in the hospital to which I was attached to store gin in the lab refrigerator in which we kept hibernating frogs that we used for pregnancy tests so that he could make martinis to deliver them to his buddies in the attached barracks, ferrying them on a gurney. By the way, this same lab tech is now a well-known gerontologist and a graduate of this institution. These experiences have helped me appreciate more than once MASH, Catch-22, and From Here to Eternity. 55 years ago last month, I shipped out to Seattle for my first and, as it turned out, only assignment after basic training as a radio broadcast specialist. I'd hoped for an assignment in the South Pacific in the Ryukyu's command, but instead wound up on a long, bumpy cross-country DC-3 ride to the port of embarkation for troops headed to or from the Far East, Fort Lawton, destined to run a broadcast network for the base hospital. And here's one of life's little ironies. 20 or so years ago, I was discharged as a Spec 4 from Fort Lawton. As a discharged Spec 4 from Fort Lawton, I became the chairman of the Seattle Parks and Recreation Commission, playing a key role in determining the fate of Fort Lawton after it had been surplus by the Department of Defense and given to the city of Seattle. citizen soldier morphing into citizen policymaker. And by the way, it's now a spectacular city park, thanks to yours truly, on the bluffs above Puget Sound. So let me now turn from the perspective of the serviceman to an institutional perspective. I'd like to spend my last 2 minutes or so recounting an institutional story that involves the University of Chicago, or more directly, the story of Extension, now known as the Graham School, my opportunity to put in a little bit of an advertisement, and its connection and support of service personnel, both active duty and separated during the Second World War and later. This story about Extension, by the way, is set in the context of a much larger story of the university's contribution to the national debate about peace and war, the critical research and training in many disciplines, and the sacrifices of its students and faculty. It is a remarkable story that deserves a telling. But my story of the university and the military is much more local. You may not know that Extension, now the Graham School, was an early innovator in distance learning, being the first American university to organize correspondence study into a coherent curriculum, and over many decades supported learners from around the country who could not come to Hyde Park, for example, teachers and military personnel. So when learning at a distance was needed by the military and its service people, Extension's home study department was prepared to deliver. It offered, as part of the nation's wartime military training programs, over 400 courses at the college and graduate levels, including a few high school courses. All fees and charges were paid by the government, even postage for letters. And I recall taking a psychology course through correspondence study, but I don't recall the postage having been provided. Building on its experience in providing correspondence study during the war, University of Chicago Extension was awarded a Navy contract following the war to provide correspondence courses for Navy personnel at all levels, officer and enlisted. Work on the project started in 1949 and ended long after the Korean War in 1962. Some of you may have been students of that program. And if you were like me, when I returned to college after military service, you not only used whatever current version of the GI Bill was at operation at the time, but you probably also sought credit for certain parts of your military training or service. My 201 file is full of military training, from fundamentals of military justice to military sanitation. That conversion of experience in the services to academic credit was and is possible as a consequence of the development of examinations used in assessing and credentialing educational experiences developed at the University of Chicago in the period following 1942. Out of the work of the University of Chicago, the American Council on Education in 1944 began publishing a guide to the evaluation of military experiences in the armed services, designed to assist institutions in determining credits for various educational experiences available through military service. The work of USAFI and the University of Chicago during and after the Second World War provided a foundation for the extension of education to military personnel and the accreditation of learning that occurs while in the service. Its impact can still be felt through the DANTES program, the Defense Activity for Non-Traditional Educational Support. The engagement of the Graham School of Continuing Liberal and Professional Studies, Extension, in support of veterans continues today through the Yellow Ribbon program. We are an early and eager participant and presently have 3 Yellow Ribbon students. Next year, we will accept all eligible students who apply and are admitted to the Graham School. We welcome this opportunity to continue to have a positive impact on the lives of those who have served this country in the spirit of Veterans Day. So I challenge you to recall the stories from your time in the service. Your stories are a rich source of understanding of who and what a veteran is. Thank you.
Just a few announcements of what we're doing to continue this engagement in community. The Alumni Relations Department set up an alumni group, And that was started in August, and Lucy Sandell is the contact person for that. The University of Chicago Veterans page on Facebook, we have a new logo, and you would see that on the Facebook page. And Aaron, where's Aaron? If you have any questions on how to get onto Facebook, you can either check with Aaron Burke or probably your kids or grandkids or coworkers. I'm sure they're well-versed in Facebooking. The National Veterans Art Museum, this is in Chicago, and it's in the South Loop at 18th in Indiana. And the University of Chicago sponsored an ad in their 30th anniversary commemorative program. They also have a new show opening today with an artist speaking at 7 o'clock. The Disabled American Veterans Group and the Harley Davidson Foundation is providing a mobile service office tomorrow out in Forsyth, Illinois. The Hawthorne Racetrack here in Chicago is having a free day for free admission for active duty and veterans. The Veterans Job Bank, this is something that was just released from the government this week. It's still new and they're still trying to figure it out, but it's part of the National Resource Directory, so if anybody needs that assistance. Joining Forces, this was an initiative from the White House led by the First Lady and Dr. Biden, and it's to help support troops and their families. There are a couple huge lists of about 200 restaurants and 200 retail stores and service providers that we will be able to email out to you. They have veterans discounts not just only today and this weekend, but sometimes throughout the year. And when I learned about that, a lot of them said that you had to have a military ID, but when you leave the service, you give your ID in, so how do you get one? AmVets is one organization for veterans where you can sign up and be part of the organization and get an ID.